Pastor Hargrave, we know the Holy Spirit will just lead and direct each part of this message. Father, we thank you. We pray that you would open our hearts and our minds to what you have for us today. In Jesus' name.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
I am thankful to be back in the house of God with my brothers and sisters. And I have enjoyed the singing and our time together to this point. I want to ask at the beginning if you would just take a moment and look around at who's in the building with us this morning. There are some special people in here. There are different age groups. Thank you. And there are different races and walks of life represented, all in the name of Jesus. That's all right. That's all right. At a time when the world, it seems, find every reason to separate, and there is a temptation for us to hang with, stick with, worship with people that are just like us, think like us, talk like us, value all the same things. But I'm excited every time I come here, because in this place there is a commitment to Christ first that takes in everybody else, and that's all right. I'd like to talk for a little while this morning about kingdom relationships. And this is a subject and a thought that is near, dear to my heart. Yesterday, my wife spoke with my aunt. I have relatives that live in South Florida. Actually, the first 20 years of my life, I lived in South Florida, and our family actually survived Hurricane Andrew. We were some of those people that did not evacuate, and I can tell you that there was several times during the course of that night where I was sure that I was going to die. It is, being in the middle of a hurricane like that is Category 5 hurricane is a frightening thing. So my wife, Friday, I believe it was, talked to one of my aunts who decided that she was not going to evacuate. And all of the family, different ones, tried to encourage her to leave, to get out. And everyone left, not her. And she decided she was going to stay. And so that stirred up a lot of emotions, feelings, memories. I am reminded, now I'm going to talk about kingdom relationships. In the book of Romans, and that's not my text, we'll read my text in a little bit. The book of Romans, the 8th chapter, the Bible says that all of creation groans. All of creation is groaning and longing for the manifestation of the people, the sons of God. Romans 8 and 21 through 22. And I think about that when I look at what's happening with the weather in our country. In the southern, southeastern parts of the United States, there are hurricanes, flooding, and disaster. In the western part of the United States, there are serious fires that are going on, and there's earthquakes, and there's political and relational earthquakes and clashing. And I believe, like the Apostle Paul said in Romans 8, that all of creation is groaning and saying, this is not the way the world is supposed to be. This is not what life was like when God created Adam in the garden. And so all of creation is waiting for the people of God and the purpose of God to be fully revealed. And we have a part. We have a part in that process. When I think about kingdom relationships, we heard last week about the body of Christ. And for this next few series of messages, we'll be talking about the kingdom relationships. The Bible is a book. This book is a book based on love. It's about love. And this is a theme, I think, from cover to cover, the love of God. In the Gospel of John, this is not my text either. The Gospel of John, the 13th chapter, Jesus talking to his disciples said, "A new commandment have I given you, that you love one another. And love, this book is a book of love. John 3:16, a common verse that we all quote. "For God so loved the world." This is a book of love. In the book of Jeremiah, chapter 31, in verse 3, God told his people that "I have loved you with an everlasting love." This is a book of love. But do we really know what love is? Now, as I get into the text, we're going to read in the book of Ephesians, the 3rd chapter. If you have your Bible, please turn there and follow along with me. We're going to read through a few verses in Ephesians, the 3rd chapter. This is my text. This book of love. Ephesians chapter 3. Beginning verse 16. I'll read verses 16 through 20. And then for a little while, I'd like to talk about these verses. Now, I do need to say this. After we get through reading, I'm going to need your help this morning in preaching the message. So there are just a few. Your role is very, very important. So there are a few things I need to say about that. If I say something and it is in your heart, in your spirit, you know it's true. There's something inside of you that says this is right. I want to encourage you to say amen. See, you have a role in this. Then there'll be a part where, because see, it's about together. It's about when we do this together. And you're going to help me preach. There'll be at least a couple of times when I ask some questions. And none of us want to be in here real, real long today. The Cleveland Browns are going to play later on. So when I ask questions, if you have an answer or want to respond, feel free to speak up. That's number two. Number one, say amen when you know that it's true and it's burning in your heart. Number two, when I ask questions and I want some input and response, help me out by answering. And then the third one is probably one of the most important, praying that God would have his way with us. So let us read now. Ephesians, the 3rd chapter, beginning at verse 16. Just follow along with me. Some powerful verses here. The Apostle Paul set the background writing, wrote this letter to the church of Ephesus, and he wanted them to be strong. He wanted them to have power and to do the work to represent the kingdom and the cause of God. And this letter, this message applies to us today. So I begin in the 16th verse, and he's saying, he's praying. He tells them in verse 14 and 15, "I'm praying for you." And in his prayer, verse 16, he says that he, talking about God, would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with power through his spirit in the inner man, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, and that you, being rooted and grounded in love, it's a book of love, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and the length and the height and the depth, and to know the love of Christ which surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled up to all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly beyond all that we ask or think, according to the power that works within us. These are interesting set of verses that I want to talk about here. If you would go to, right there, leave it there for a moment, our key verse, one of the key verses, to know the love of Christ that passeth knowledge. If you look at these words, there are two things that don't seem to make sense. He says, know the love of Christ, and then he says, it surpasses, or it's too big to really know it all. But know this love, know this love. And so I want to talk about that. And so my first question to you, if you would raise your hand, this is your participation part. Raise your hand if you have ever loved someone, anyone, or been loved by someone. Raise your hand. If you've ever loved someone, oh, there's some hands that didn't go up. I love you. Everybody that didn't put your hand up. Now you're loved. But what does love mean? I think we all have some ideas about what that is, and I'm going to ask you this question to share a little bit what love is to you. If you would go to, and I need you to advance probably three or four slides for a moment, go ahead, keep going till you get to the pictures, my first picture. Excellent, thank you so much. What is love? Oh, by the way, Tim, I know we didn't rehearse this. I'll have you bouncing around maybe a little bit. You're just fine, you'll do great. What is love? There are many expressions of love, and in the picture behind me, there are two people. Look, pay attention to the expressions on their face. It's just, if you had to say or put it in words, it's like I can't say it in words, but is that love? Is that an expression of love? Go ahead, next slide. I love you is a phrase that you often hear. Now, isn't that sweet? Man and woman making a big old heart, that has to be love. Love is one of the greatest, most, this is the Bible again, is a book of love. But what really is that? And when the Bible tells us to love one another, what does that mean? What does it really mean? If you would go to the next slide. Now, this is not a really, really good picture. And what I looked for, I could not find it. I wanted a picture of, that's golden fried chicken. And by the way, I love chicken. I tried to find a picture that had the golden fried chicken, a big pile of warm, buttery biscuits, some fried beans and rice. Yes. I love that meal. But what does it mean? So I love my wife. I love my children. I love fried chicken. What does love mean? If you would go to our next picture for a moment. I have to tell you that a wolf loves sheep. Oh, yes, they do. They love them. What does love really mean? I think if we look at those pictures, some of the pictures that we've seen, I have a couple more that I want to show you in a moment. But as we look at those, all of those expressions fall under love. And I wonder if the people of God and the people, if our love for one another is kind of like those pictures. For example, in the very first one, the husband and wife kind of love. Do you know that in the United States today, over half of all marriages end in divorce? But at some point, those people have said to one another, I love you. I love you. If you look at the next picture, I love the one with the fried chicken. Think about what happens with that. I do love it. But what happens to that chicken when you put it in front of me at mealtime? Yes, it has a short lifespan, and so my love for it results in its demise. I wonder if our love for one another many times is kind of like that. Someone says that I love you, but if you connect with them, their whole desire is to consume you. I love you. I'll go ahead and next slide. Here's another one of the wolf. Now this one is a picture, and it doesn't, I couldn't get it real clear. There's a young boy, and if you just beyond the grass that you see, that he's at the top of a steep hill, and there's water. It's kind of a soppy, marshy kind of a setting, and the whole terrain around them, it's hill country. And he has his younger brother, sibling, on his back. What an expression of love, carrying. When someone is willing to carry you, the Bible says in one place, bear ye one another's burdens. And so, what is love? Do we really know what that is and what it means when God says, I love you? One more, our last pictorial slide. A few years ago, wife, I'll need you to stop me at about the 15 minutes from now. Yeah, I'll pick it up here in a moment. About 20 years ago, my wife and I worked for an organization with at-risk teens. We were house parents. We lived in a group home with young people that, for whatever reasons, could not be with their family. Some of them, their families did not want them. Some, just a variety of reasons. And they had this picture is one that they used, and the home where I worked was founded by a Catholic priest. You may have heard of it. It was called Boys Town, out of Omaha, Nebraska. And there it was told of that home that this young boy in the picture, there was a young boy who was in the snow carrying on his back one of his brother. And the priest asked him and told him, wow, he must be heavy. The young boy did not fully understand. And he said, no, he ain't heavy, Father. In other words, his name's not heavy. He's my brother. What is love? I can tell you, like the Apostle Paul, and I'm getting ready to get into our text, Ephesians, the third chapter, because knowing the love of Christ and what real love is the key for us, representing the power of God in the world today. This idea of I love you today and I don't tomorrow is not in the Bible. When we compare our love, the love we have experienced from other people, with the love that God has, it falls short. It falls short. But God's love, that's what I want to talk about. And in order for us, kingdom relationships, in order for us to love one another the right way, the Apostle Paul teaches us what the starting point is. Ephesians, the third chapter again, and the 17th verse, he says, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you being rooted or grounded in love. If you are trying to serve God, if you are trying to love your brothers and sisters, if you're trying to do that from your own strength, from your own ability, you're going to fall short. It starts first with knowing how much God loves you. The most sad thing that I come face to face with every day for the last 20-some years in my work. I've worked with at-risk youth and families in many different ways, sometimes as a counselor in Akron, Wayne County, all over. And the most sad thing that I run into is a young person who does not know that they are loved. Now, what makes someone worthy of love? What do you have to do to be loved? What do you have to do to be valued? The Bible is a book of love, and boy, the world puts a lot of store, and it has its own definition of love. So if you are smart enough, if you can make good grades, if your teachers like you, I love you. Good job. Your daddy loves you. When you bring home your report card, daddy, I got A. Oh, I love you. What makes a person worthy of love? I remember when we had our first child, our son, and I was there at the hospital with my wife when he was born, and I remember after they cleaned him up and they showed him to us, my wife's face did just like this. She said, when I looked at him, a wonderful boy, I remember thinking to myself, he looks like a lizard. That I have seen some newborn babies, like, you know, pictures of newborn babies, and in the nursery, they look, oh, so sweet. Not my wonderful son. Now, to his mother, and you know, I've heard a saying that this person has a face that only a mother could love. I did not know what that meant until then, but I remember when, stay with me, kingdom relationships, what makes a person worthy of love. Later on, somebody came in with a camera and they said, oh, we want to take pictures. This is the same day. We want to take pictures of your newborn baby and so you can buy them. And I'm still thinking to myself, who wants pictures? But you know what his mother said? Oh, yes. And you know what I said? Yes. I might show you those pictures. What makes a person worthy of love? Is it how you look? Is it how well you can speak? Is it how much money you make? Is it how tall or how short? Is it how big your muscles are? What makes a person worthy of love? Is it the things that they accomplish in this life? See, all of those things have to do with the love of the world. But the Bible says that God so loved the world. Hallelujah. There's another verse where he says, while we were yet in sin, Christ died for the ungodly. The Bible says, greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life. If we're starting to talk about love, now there are, in the Hebrew and in the Greek, there are several words for love. They're just in the English Bible and in our other Bibles, they're just translated love. But in the original meanings, there are several different words for love. And so I want to touch on them just a moment. If you would go back to, I think, my third slide there, Brother Tim, thank you. As he is going to that slide, in the Hebrew, I need to say this, that there is kingdom relationships starts with knowing how much God loves us. If you think that there's something you have to do to earn that love, you don't understand what God has for us. See, for earthly fathers and parents and employers and all of those things, we have to earn at times. We have to earn it to a degree. Some of us had parents that were too busy to spend time, that were too busy to read a bedtime story. Oh, I thank God. I want to say this as an encouragement. Love, real love, is not something that is earned. Not real love, not divine love. But I have many a precious memory. When I was a boy, my father would say his prayers, tuck me in and say prayers. And I'll never forget the prayer that he taught me. He would say, now I lay me down to sleep. I would have to repeat this after him. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die before I awake, I pray the Lord my soul to take. It didn't mean a whole lot then, but as time has gone on, I now recognize that at the end of a long day of work and all of the stressors and all of the things that happened, for my father to delay his rest for just a while to come in and say that prayer, oh, that was love. Real love, you cannot earn it. And so may God help us to take time. Love is not something, real love is not something that you earn. Oh, that was a weekend, man. That's okay. I'm gonna preach this again in a few months. Remember, love is not something that you earn. For God so loved the world, before you did anything to deserve it. love, what is love? So the Apostle Paul, so time's going to run out of me. Love, did you find that word, Hebrew word? Next slide, here we go. I'm going to teach you, didn't translate in the Hebrew letter, didn't translate in the PowerPoint. I'm going to teach all of you some Hebrew, the Hebrew word for love. The Bible was, The Bible was originally written in Hebrew, the first half of it, Genesis to Malachi, was written in the Hebrew language, and from Matthew to Revelation was written in Greek. And so a lot of times I like to refer to the Hebrew language because it gives you more insight and it gives you a clearer picture. There is the notion today, and I don't even like to call the Bible the Old Testament. It implies to me when you say something is old, it's not as important sometimes. It doesn't have the same amount of value sometimes. Old, it's something better now when you say old and new. The Bible is one book, and the more we can understand all of it, there is a greater blessing for us. And so, but I want to call this back. So this word, I'm going to teach you this word, and just repeat it after me. I'm going to say it all together, and then I'll break it down. A beautiful word. The Hebrew word for love, God's love for us, is ahava. Ahava.
Aha,
uh-huh. Good. You got it. Now, I'll break it down. This is good. Let it stick. Now, I'll say it in two parts. Aha.
Ahava.
Put it together. Ahava.
Yes,
sir. Love. That is divine love. That's God's love. Now, here is a beautiful thing about Bible study. And I think as we get into some of our classes in the rest of the year, those things, I want to share more and more insights of this. But one of the best ways to get a picture of what God is talking about when he says, I love you, is find the original word, the original Hebrew, the very first time that word is used in the Bible. Now here's where I want a little help. The very first time this word, ahava, is used in the Bible is in Genesis chapter 29. Now I want somebody to read that. Austin, would you read that when you find it for me? Genesis chapter 29 and beginning. Let's start at verse 18. This word, ahava. And so you go to the very first place where that word is used in the Bible, and you read the story. And as you read the story, you get a clear picture of what this means. Now, our definition says, ahava, or love, is a state or condition of strong affection for another based on the relationship. So it's strong affection. I told you it's not a conditional thing in some of the verses that I quoted at the beginning. But if you go to this text where he's going to read some of it, I won't read it all, but this is a picture of what ahava, divine love, this is a picture of what it looks like when you read this story. So this is a story of Jacob, of brother Jacob, and this, the woman that he loved. So we're just going to read a few verses of it, and I'll have to tell you the rest of it, and that's where I will pause today. Go ahead, listen to this story.
Verse 18?
Yes, sir, 18.
Jacob loved Rachel.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, I will serve you 7 years for the younger daughter of Rachel.
Okay, so now paraphrasing, you're great, man. I'm going to stop you a lot. In this text, Jacob was running for his life. If you were to read up chapter 28, 27, he'd gotten in trouble with his family, and he was running for his life, and he went to live with his in-laws, his mom's people. And so while he was at a well, this lady came. Now, I'm going to tell my version of it. You can read it and see how the Bible says it, but just to speed it up. And so he said, this girl is gorgeous. And he was smitten by her. The Bible says that when he saw her, he ran up to her, kissed her, and started crying. Boy, she had to be gorgeous. When I remember as a boy, I grew up in South Florida. My lovely wife is here, and their family, they live in Akron, Ohio. And so our families, we'd drive up to Akron as a little boy. We'd drive up and visit and be with them, and they would come down to Florida at times and be with us. And I always thought my wife was hot stuff. Yeah, I did. But I never ran up to her and kissed her and started crying. Yeah, there's some. But Rachel was so fill in the blanks. Jacob did that. And so he like, take me to your dad. She took him home, and he said, listen, this is where Oscar read. I love her. Let me marry her. Read that again, verse 18.
Jacob loved Rachel.
Uh-huh.
And he said, I will serve you 7 years for your younger daughter, Rachel.
I will serve you seven. Please, brothers, if you're here today and you are married, do not answer this question out loud. How many of you would serve your father-in-law for 7 years just to marry his daughter? My father-in-law is here, so I'm not going to answer that out loud. But I can tell you this. Boy. When I proposed to my wife, this is aha, we're learning what divine love is. We were at a large convention for our church, and I had thought carefully about what I wanted to tell my father-in-law. I didn't do as good as you did. That was good with the balloons and all that. That was good. But I thought about what I wanted to tell him because I loved her. Jacob just says, I love your daughter and I'll serve you 7 years. But what I told him after, it was after church service, because he's a very good preacher and minister and all that. And so I figured you catch him after a church service and the chances are going to be real good. I do need to tell you that my wife was in her fourth year, I believe, of college. Going to be starting her fourth year of college. My plan, when I talked to my wife, this was my plan. We knew we loved each other before I told her dad that we were ready to be married. And my plan was, we'll get married, she'll move with me, I was in New Orleans at that time, she'll move in with me and finish school in New Orleans. That was my plan. And so, I thought, what I need to tell him is that just like in the beginning with Adam and Eve, when God put Adam to sleep and he took the rib out and she was the perfect one for him, I told him, you know, I found my rib. Just like for Adam and Eve, your daughter has my rib and I want to marry her. It didn't work. He was okay, I think, with the idea of marriage, but he said, you know, she's in her last year of school. You don't have to say amen. And I listened to him, being respectful, and I explained that, yes, but this is real love. And he said, if it's real love, it can wait. Oh, I wasn't done. I said, if it's real love, why wait? If it's the real thing, what are you waiting for? She finished her last year. Jacob was willing to work 7 years. Now read that next verse.
Laban said, it is better that I give her to you than I should give her to any other man. Stay with me. So Jacob served 7 years for Rachel, and they seemed to him but a few days because of the love he had for her.
Woo! Seemed like just a few days. I can tell you that year I waited for her to graduate did not seem like just a few days. It seemed long. It took a lot of prayer for me to make peace with my father-in-law. We're good now. We're good. We worked together in ministry. No, but it took some. But Jacob really loved her. Now, you know, I think this is probably a good place for me to begin to wrap it up for today. I want to talk about love and ahava and connection for a little bit. So here's where I want to end. Real love, ahava, divine love. Or to say it another way, the first step is recognizing and realizing how much God loves us, loves you. If our experience with the other relationships in our life has been, you're not good enough. You're not the smart child or the creative child or the tallest or shortest or strongest, whatever it was. If you had people that measured your value by what you could do for them, you will struggle to really understand God's love. But God said he saw you in your mother's womb. Before you were born, he counted the hairs on your head. And God loves you. And it is only when we can begin to understand how deep the Father's love for us that we can begin to love other people. If we don't realize that love for us, we will make our love for others conditional. Well, that's why churches all over the world today, when this Bible is a book of love, are largely segregated. Even, and I get it, I'm not calling anybody names, but it takes some ahava to work with people that are different than you. Don't you know that other people, not any of us here, other people have issues. And anytime you start to get close to them and try to build relationships, they're going to do some strange things at some point that don't make sense. And real divine love is a choice. If you read 1 Corinthians, the 13th chapter, it says love is patient. There goes the chicken. Remember the picture of the chicken? The love I have for that ain't patient. As soon as we get through saying the blessing, it's gone. Love is kind. Love does not keep record of wrong. Uh-oh. How many of us in here keep track of it when somebody does you wrong? I have to stop. This is going to get good. But to know the Apostle Paul, Austin, help us. I don't go further. Just read you Ephesians, the 3rd chapter. Oh, that chicken, wonderful. Ephesians, the 3rd chapter in closing for me. Those verses 17, I think it is, through 20. Listen to this. This is the heart of the message. This is the key to power. This is the key to kingdom relationships. It's not going out working, serving. I'm not late for church. I read my Bible 20 times every day. That's not the key to power and working for God. The key is right here in these verses. Knowing how much God loves you just like you are. A little bit of amen. Go ahead and read that. Close.
So that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you being rooted and grounded in love may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen. I'm telling you to turn that PowerPoint off. And if you wouldn't mind playing here, I want to have prayer. That 20th verse that he read says, now to him who is able to do abundantly or far beyond anything you could ask or think. But he says what it depends on. According to the power that is working within us. You know what that power is? Love. That's why he started by saying being rooted and grounded in love, God's love for you. The bigger and deeper and better that is, we can do some powerful things for the kingdom of God. Let us, I want to pray, and I'm going to ask as we are praying in your heart to the Lord, if he brings something to your mind, an area where your love, number one, for God, is based on him doing something for you, that's not real love. If your love for one another, your brothers and sisters, your co-workers, your neighbors, if your love is based on them thinking like you, seeing life like you, that's not real love. And so, as we pray, if God brings something to your mind, in your heart, just tell him. Just apologize. Ask forgiveness. And the real answer is asking him to reveal to you his love for you in a deeper way. We all know that God loves us. We all know that. But I need a deeper revelation. I need more. I want to know more. Heavenly Father, thank you for this assembly this morning. Little old Wayne County, Salem Mennonite Church. This group of people that have gathered here this morning in your name. Father, no doubt there are some of us in here who have not been good enough for the people around us. We carry those scars of rejection. Pray that you would heal us with a greater understanding of how much you love us, how deep your love for us is. Reveal it to us, Father, so that we can love one another. I pray that the little things we could fight over and stand up for, that we would let go of them to connect with our brothers. Not that it's heavy, just like Jacob said, 7 years was just a short while.